what God has done for me. Today, I would like to focus on Thanksgiving. Do you realize that we are commanded by God to give thanks every day, all the time, for everything? To whom do we give thanks? Psalm 92, verse 1 to 15. Let us read Psalm 92 and we see what God has done for me. It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, to shew forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness at night, upon an instrument of 10 strings and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hand. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. A brutish man knoweth not, neither doth a fool understand this. When the wicked spring as grass, and when the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. But thou, O Lord, art most high for everyone. For lo, thy enemies, O Lord, for lo, thy enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn shalt thou exalt, like the horn of an unicorn. I shall be anointed with fresh oil. Mine eye also shall see my desire on all mine enemies, and mine ears shall hear my desire of the wicked that rise up against me. The righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those who be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourished. They shew that the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. What a wonderful song to sing on the Lord's day. It is good to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, because he is my rock, my Savior. To whom do we give thanks? To the Lord. And when you see all the four letters capitalized, Lord, you know it is a synonym for the Hebrew letters YHWH, which means Jehovah. Who is Jehovah? The New Testament informs us that God the Father is Jehovah, that God the Son is Jehovah, and that God the Holy Spirit is Jehovah. To whom do we lift up our prayers of thanksgiving? The Lord Jesus asked this same question, and he answered, "When you pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven." We lift up our voices to the Father. When do we give thanks? Psalm 92, verse 2. What do we read in Psalm 92, verse 2? To shew forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness at night. Actually, the Hebrew word for loving kindness is much better translated by mercy. The psalm says, it is good to give thanks unto the Lord, to declare his mercy in the morning, and to declare his faithfulness every night. It is only in the morning and in the night that we give God thanks for his mercy and for his faithfulness. Well, think again. If our gratitude for his mercy and his faithfulness is not demonstrated between morning and evening, then most likely it is not present at all. This matter of thankfulness is extremely important in the life of a Christian. If we are not living a life that is filled with gratitude to God, then we should seriously consider if we have been saved. What is God's mercy in that Psalm 92 verse 2 speaks about? Technically, God's mercy means that God is withholding what we deserve. That is the definition of mercy. We all are born as sinners, and we all deserve to go to hell for our sins. If God is withholding the penalty of hell from us, what did God do with that penalty? Did God just wave his hand and make our sins disappear? Did God just wave his hand and make this penalty disappear? No. God is righteous. He cannot do that. God declared his law book that the wages of sin is death, and the death that God has in view is the second death. The payment for our sin is spending an eternity in hell. If God has mercy on us, it means that God is doing something with our sins. And God is doing something with our penalty. The Bible declares that God loaded our sins on the Lord Jesus Christ, and he suffered the penalty for our sins. Then, did Christ then spend the equivalent of hell for our sins? Well, look at all the Old Testament animal sacrifices. The Bible declares that all the Old Testament animal sacrifices were shadows of Christ's atonement on the cross. The cross was his altar, where all the animals brought onto the altar and killed. Yes, where the animals then buried. What was the end of it? No. The animals were always burned with fire as a picture that hellfire was necessary to atone for the sins of the people. And when we look at the cross of Christ, where is the fire? The fire was not outwardly visible, but was inside. That was the reason why Christ had to be fully God, so that he could endure what no human being could endure. If only suffering in the flesh is needed, then just human flesh would have been sufficient. That is what the Jehovah Witnesses believe. But they have no Savior, because the suffering in Christ's atonement was so great that no human flesh could endure it. The faithfulness of Christ in going to the cross and enduring the penalty for us, the equivalent of an eternity in hell, that is the faithfulness that Psalm 92 verse 2 speaks about. How can we not be grateful for that between morning and evening? It is impossible not to be grateful. How shall we give thanks? Psalm 92 verse 3. Let's move on in Psalm 92 verse 3 says, upon an instrument of 10 strings and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. Is this how we mechanically should give thanks, God thanks for what he has done for us? But our God does not look upon outward display. Our God looks upon the heart. Christ said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And how does that thanksgiving come about, come out of a person? Oh yes, sometimes we want to sing aloud and accompany our singing with musical instrument, but our thanksgiving really shows in our obedience to his commandments. This is clearly demonstrated in the example that Christ gave in John 21. There we read, so when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said unto him, yeah, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he said unto him, feed my lambs. First of all, the Lord Jesus is reinstating Peter, who denied him a couple weeks earlier. Now, Peter is again an apostle, which means he is chosen and is sent by Jesus with a special commission. What was that commission? Jesus said, feed my lambs. Feed my little ones, the spiritual food of the Bible, which is the nourishment to their souls. Don't feed them heavy doctrine. Feed them the food that they will not choke on. Feed them first the simple stuff until they grow up. Tell them about Christ crucified, and tell them why he had to be crucified. Tell them about sin and about God's grace and mercy. But Peter, don't forget the bigger sheep. Then the Lord Jesus said in verse 16, John 21 verse 16, he said to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, yeah, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he said unto him, feed my sheep. Allow me to paraphrase what I'm reading. Peter, don't forget to teach the whole counsel of God. Remember what Jesus told to Nicodemus. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Ye must be born from above. Ye must teach the bigger sheep that it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that sheweth mercy. And then Jesus said in verse 17, John 21 verse 17, he said unto him a third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. Peter was grievous because he said unto him a third time, lovest thou me? did Jesus intensely grieve Peter? No. Paraphrased, Jesus said to Peter, and he also said it unto us, are you sure that you love me? Can you examine yourself if you really love me? Does your life really show that you love me? And if that's so, feed my sheep. This is how we give thanks to God. Do our actions reveal that we are feeding his sheep? And why do we give thanks? Psalm 92, verse 4. What is it to give thanks? What is it we have to thank him for? Look at what we find in Psalm 92, verse 4. For thou, O Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph, I will rejoice in the works of thy hands. In this verse, the Hebrew word for triumph could be much better translated by the word rejoice. In the LITV, version of the Bible said, for thou hast caused me to rejoice, O Jehovah, in thy work concerning the works of thy hands do I sing. Does God have hands? The Bible says in John 4, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. A spirit does not have hands. But when God, the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, came down to earth 2,000 years ago, he took on a human body. Christ has hands, and from that time forth, we can say that God has hands. What was the work of thy hands that made me rejoice? The Lord Jesus stilled the storm. He healed the sick. He healed the eyes of the blind. He even raised up the dead. But all these things were not the primary reason why he came to this earth. The first and foremost reason why the Lord Jesus came to this earth was to atone for our sins and to be nailed to a wooden cross. These nails were piercing in his hands. Therefore, when we read, I will rejoice in the work of thy hands, this primarily refers to the work the Lord Jesus did for us on the cross. And when he completed suffering for our sins, the equivalent of an eternity in hell, he cried with a loud voice, it is finished. We can rejoice in that because it means that all those people for whom the Lord Jesus paid their sins on the cross, for the sins on the cross, do not have to go to hell. All their sins have been paid for. What a great rejoicing is this. And the Lord Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me has everlasting life. That is certainly the reason to rejoice. That is certainly the reason to give thanks to him. What has God done for me? Personally, I give God thanks for giving me all kinds of things in my personal life. I'm very glad for it and thankful. But all these things are very insignificant compared to what Christ has done for me on the cross at Golgotha. And for what God has done for me in confronting me with the gospel of salvation and giving me a little understanding in the Bible. and for teaching me that my name is written in heaven, for giving me a ministry. I am delightful for God's guiding hand throughout my life, and I pray that everyone here may receive such a favor from God. Those who are born again, who are reading this, can give thanks to God that He has saved us through the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. But do we realize what it takes to bring one sinner into God's holy heaven? Do we realize that the Creator of the universe had to come down to earth to take upon Himself the body of a man and become subject to the wrath of God? Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise Him. Isaiah 53 verse 10. These are strange words that we find here in Isaiah 53 verse 10 and 12. But when we study those strange words, they give us precisely the meaning and the reason behind the atoning work of Christ on the cross. That is what it takes to bring one sinner into God's holy heaven. Isaiah 53 verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, and he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Allow me to paraphrase the situation. We read in verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. The Bible says, there is not one human being accepted. Everyone, even the little babies, come out of the womb speaking lies. Everyone who comes into the world is an unregenerate state because they have sinned. Everyone is in need of being saved from this slippery slide into hell. Only in the Lord Jesus there is any hope of not sliding into the hell. But who wants to hear this? Who wants to hear this? To all who want to hear and believe this, God says that He transferred our souls, our sins, that He transferred our sins, past, present, and future sins, on the Lord Jesus Christ. He could not miss one. If He had forgotten one of our sins, then we would have to pay for that one sin an eternity in hell, because God's law says that the wages of sin is death, which means that we would have to suffer the second death for that sin. Nearly 2,000 years ago, the Lord Jesus, charged with our sins, stood for the judgment throne of the governor Pilate in Jerusalem. But spiritually, He stood before the judgment throne of God. How could He go back into heaven? He could not go back into God's holy heaven with all those sins charged to Him. Those sins first had to be paid in full. And so the Lord Jesus suffered both in body and in His soul for those sins, an equivalent of an eternity in hell. That was the payment required. And that was what His Father inflicted Him with. That is why we have to read Isaiah 53 verse 10 as follows. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. And then the Lord repeats this message in Isaiah 53 verse 10 with the words, He has put him to grief. Let us continue in Isaiah 53 verse 10. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. We see that Christ did not just offer his body, but also his soul, which is his divine spirit. He suffered body, both body and his spirit. Continue in Isaiah 53 verse 10 with the words, he shall see his seed. Christ shall know them for whom he came to atone for their sins. There are others in the world who never will become saved and who never want such a salvation because they are too proud to admit that they have nothing to offer God. Christ did not spend the equivalent of an eternity in hell for those who themselves are going to hell. Let's continue in Isaiah 53 verse 10. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his name, in his hand, sorry. This is how we read Isaiah, and this is how we must read Isaiah 53 verse 10. This is why Christ must suffer in body and his soul. If we focus only on Christ's suffering in his body, we go astray very quickly. For example, how many tens of thousands of people would have been saved for each second his body hung on the cross? Did he really pay the full payment for all their sins? And did Christ only pay a token of the required payment? Another example, the two thieves on the crosses hanging next to him suffered in their body as much or much more than the Lord Jesus. When Jesus died, the legs of those two thieves were broken. Just imagine the pain when someone breaks both legs with a baseball bat. Therefore, now can we understand the word, it pleased the Lord to bruise him, since the Lord Jesus suffered a great deal more than was outwardly visible. He died much sooner than Pilate or the centurion expected, but he died exactly at the right time, at about 3 in the afternoon on the Friday, on that Friday, which was when the Passover lambs were killed in the temple at Jerusalem. This was God's plan all along, from before the foundation of the world. No one could frustrate God's plan. He had to die as the testator of God's covenant. He had to die. For where a covenant is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. But because Christ made a full payment for our sins, that is why the Lord shall be satisfied, Isaiah 53 verse 11. The Father will be satisfied. God's righteousness will be untarnished. God's righteousness demands that every sin be paid by an equivalent of an eternity in hell. And the Lord Jesus Christ satisfied that requirement for all those whom he came to save. The Lord God says in Isaiah 53 verse 11, he shall see of the travail of his soul, shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. If we substitute again the persons of the Trinity, verse 11 reads as follows: He, the Father, shall see the travail of his soul, Christ's soul, and the Father shall be satisfied. And the Lord Jesus Christ has suffered in his soul the equivalent of an eternity in hell, and the Father is satisfied. No more will the persons who carry these same sins be required to pay the penalty of hell. And then is it that the Lord Jesus says, But I say unto you that every idle word that man shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Obviously, these words must be sins that have not been paid at the cross. Obviously, this proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Lord Jesus Christ did not pay for the sins of every human being. Let's go to Isaiah 53, verse 11. There we read, By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, but not all. For he shall bear their iniquities. The Lord Jesus shall know whom he is justifying. For Christ shall bear their sins and shall bear the guilt of their sins. The Bible says that there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. If we are in Christ, then we were crucified with Christ, and then we have died with Christ, and we were buried with Christ, and we were raised with Christ. Therefore, if Christ endured the equivalent of an eternity in hell while we were in him, then we have successfully passed through hell with him, and God would never require that we would go to hell again. That is why there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Thanks to Christ we have the victory. Let us read about the victory in Isaiah 53, verse 12. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressor, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Christ obtained the victory for us, and that is why Christ is called the firstborn among many brethren. The reason why we remained strong was not because we were so strong, but because he is strong and he kept us by his grace. He obtained the victory because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sins of many, and he made intercession for the transgressors. To say it in reverse, he made intercession for us transgressors, because he bare our sins. and purchased us by pouring out his soul unto death, and the second death, as the righteousness of God requires. Again, the suffering of his soul is the main issue in this verse, as it is in all the three verses of Isaiah 53 that we have looked at. Now let's turn back to Psalm 92. We have made this excursion to Isaiah 53 to get an understanding of the sufferings of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. And after looking into Isaiah 53, we have to admit, O Lord, thy thoughts are very deep. Psalm 92, verse 5. This is exactly what we read here in Psalm 92, verse 5. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. O Lord, when we read about your works in the Bible, for example, how you freed the children of Israel out of Egypt, and how you parted the Red Sea, and how these historical events are also pictures of redemption, we have to admit, Lord, that your works are very great. But these works cannot even stand in the shadow of your coming to earth as man and purchasing our redemption on the cross. We have not even begun to uncover the spiritual mysteries you have hidden in the Old Testament and in the New Testament of a truth, O Lord. Your works are very great. Your thoughts are very deep. Help us that we will not swing to the other end and imagine things that are contrary to the Bible. When you think of the fact that God before the foundation of the world already worked out everything that we see and hear and read in the scriptures, we can only stand in awe of this Almighty God who says, I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. And just to think that this great God calls his children is incomprehensible. We cannot even understand that Christ died for the ungodly. As God says in Romans 5, we understand even less when we read that these ungodly beings are being raised to the status of sons of God. This is what God has done for me. Is it that any wonder that we read here in Psalm 92 verse 4, I will triumph in the works of thy hands. If God be for us, who will be against us? We read in Psalm 92 verse 4, for thou, O Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph or rejoice in the works of thy hands. It is true that the first meaning of these words is, I will rejoice in the works of thy hands. And we do rejoice in the fact that Christ purchased us and saved us from this slippery slide into hell. But if he saved us by his grace, should we not only expect that he would keep us by his grace? In other words, not only can we rejoice in the works of our salvation, but we also triumph over besetting sins in our lives, because Christ is also giving us that victory. We can certainly triumph over the works of his hands, For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. But as long as we live in this sinful flesh, we will remain subject to temptations and feelings of inferiority. It is good then to remember the words of Lamentations 3, verse 22 and 23, that we read, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." If God would not hold us up, we would fall instantly. It is only because of the Lord's mercy and grace that we have become adopted as his children. We have not contributed anything to this blessed state. Therefore, since we have been planted in the house of the Lord, Psalm 92, verse 13, we can be sure that we will also be nurtured in the house of the Lord. We read in Psalm 92, verse 13, "Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God." Are we aware that we have been planted in the house of the Lord? Do we like it? Do we live like children of the King? Or are we beset with feelings of sorry for ourselves? Let me dwell here a moment with those who feel sorry for themselves. Did you know that this is the beginning of something very ugly? You end up in the office of a psychiatrist. He is not going to cure your self-pity. Instead, he is going to give you pills and more pills. And these pills have their side effects, which you cannot even fathom 20 years from now, because they keep on inventing more pills and stronger pills. The end result is that if you are still alive 30 years from now, you are reduced to a vegetable. And it all started with the feeling sorry for yourself. Turn it around. Throw this awful sin away from you. Read this psalm 100 times. Never stop giving thanks for everything that God puts on your path. Never take things for granted. Never forget that God is lavishing on us his great and wonderful spiritual blessings. It is never normal what God has given us. Just remember that in Revelation 2 and 3, 5 out of 7 churches became lukewarm. Keep praising God if he kept us faithful all these years. And never stop to be thankful for what God has done for us. We are planted in the house of the Lord. Let us remember the words of this Psalm 92. Amen.